happy?
Yes. We have dignitaries from various walks of life. Mr. M. Chandrasekhar, IPS, Joint Commissioner of Police. Thank you, sir, for being with us this morning. We also understand he is an IIT graduate, worked with Infosys and made it to the police branch. Dr. Dominic Dixon, Chairman, More Trust and a Provost of Ethos Institute. We welcome, he's the Editor-in-Charge, HIS ML Radio, Veritas Television Network. We welcome you, sir, a very profound man who works for social justice. Mr. Bansi Kalapa, Senior Correspondent of News 9. So, definitely he is going to make our college into the news today in the news channel. Thank you for being with us this morning, Mr. Kalapa. We are honored to have our very own alumni, Shubha Punja, and she has gone into acting. We are so happy for her. Our alumni are doing well once they leave the college in various fields. Thank you, Shubha, for being with us this morning. She's into acting and she says she's already acted in 27 films.
I thank my friend Dominic, the management of the college, the principal, Esther Prasanna Kumar, and Mrs. Chaudhary, and all the students for giving me this opportunity to speak to you, to interact with you. I have to limit my speech to cybercrime. Cybercrime, you never have physical contact. It is always going to be a person maybe sitting in New York, or he may be sitting just next to you in the next cyber cafe, and he may be doing things. He may be sending abusive mails, or he may be taking away your money. What he may be taking away, you have the intellectual property violations, which your intellectual property is being stolen by some other people. So you have different type of offenses that are happening, and detection has become extremely difficult because there is no physical contact between the victim and the accused. I feel that some set of guidelines have to be given to the present cyber users also. This is number one, your password. It may be your email password, it may be your bank e-banking password or any other password. It should be robust enough. Robust enough means it should have it should be alphanumerical, and a minimum of 10 characters should be there. And you must be in a position to change it once in 6 months or so. You should be able to change it, because you have password breaking tools also available which can break the best of passwords. But of course, if you keep changing it once in 6 months, it will stand you in good stead. Important thing, you should avoid sites which are dubious in nature and which talk about downloading some tool. Nothing comes free in this world. You have to be extremely careful. You will have so many free tools which are available in the internet, where you say you can download, but you should take everything with a pinch of salt. In the meanwhile, you should not get some virus or malware into your system, and you should have a very strong firewall. And we had a lot of cases which we have successfully solved. And it is an evolving field. We have experts. We take the help of private experts also while solving such cases. I would like to repeat, eternal vigilance is the price of democracy. Democracy is something good that we have got, that the people of this world has got. Now we have something more good. The cyber world is something which is more good. You have more opportunities. You can interact with more number of people. But you have to be careful and you have to be vigilant.
I'm so excited to be here. When I was invited for the talk on colonialism and language, colonial mindset and language stereotypes, I was wondering whether I should have worn a lungi instead of a pant, and should have spoken in Kannada, but I guess I was allowed to dress the way I want and speak in the language of English. I want to thank Shilpi Chowdhury for inviting me. Thank you, Madam Principal, distinguished guest. Thank you, Madam President and Madam General Secretary for the invitation. A colonial mindset. The irony of me speaking on this topic is that I am an Anglo-Indian. Do you know what an Anglo-Indian is? Do I look like an Anglo-Indian? No, thank you. I'm a chocolate Anglo-Indian. You know, when I was small, everyone in my family, my entire generation were fair-skinned. So they used to call me different demeaning names. So I made up something. So when people used to ask me, how come your brothers and your sisters are so fair and you are so black? You look like a Negro. So I said, when God made the little children, God made them in the day. When God made the little Negroes, He made them in the night. God made them in a hurry and forgot to make them white. So the colonial mindset, I've been growing up with this stereotype that you got to look in a particular way, you got to be tall. Look at me, I'm short, brown and handsome. So society asks us to behave in a particular manner, to conform in a particular manner. Society has, what has the British done? The main thing of colonialism is this, to instill inferiority. When the British came, they made us feel that we are black, we are brown, we are inferior. Archbishop Desmond Tutu, who fought against apartheid in Africa, he made the statement. He said that when the British came to Africa, they came with a cross, they came with a Bible. They told us, let us pray and close our eyes. When we close our eyes and then when we open our eyes, we had the Bible and they had our land. So this is what the British have done. They have conquered nothing but our self-identity. Our Indian heritage, you know, when I was at one of the international programs, somebody interviewed, the presenter invited my colleague on stage and said, this is so and so, he is from a third world country. And my friend went on stage and he said, what do you mean that India is a third world country? We have existed, we have about a 5,000 year history. The point that I'm trying to get is this. We Indians would rather buy a fake Rolex watch than a genuine Titan. Our girls, not you, I'm talking about the other college girls, would rather buy a fake Armani than buy an Indian product. Why is it? It is simply because we have laid in our mindsets that we need the best, even though it is fake. That we need something superior. We have taught us, we have learned, or rather, let me put it this way, in psychology, a person can train another individual to become a victim. Like many of us are victims. Look at you look at the music industry, you look at the film industry, you look at the church. Everywhere, people suppress people. And one of my debates with Preeti Zinta, this is what it was, when the Marie Claire magazine had come out, both of us were interviewed. And this is the statement I made, how is it okay for Aishwarya Rai, or even now, what's the latest Bollywood actress name? Sunny Leon. How is it okay for Sunny Leon to dance half naked on the silver screen and be a demigoddess, but how is it not okay for a poor girl to dance in a cabaret bar to earn her livelihood? Isn't that discrimination? When I debated this, I said, how is it? In 1998, this was banned in Bangalore, it was banned in India. And when I asked these girls, why do you dance at the cabaret bars with revelations of parts of your body? And they said, sir, you're the first person to ask us, and this is what it is. Our parents are sick, we are from a poor family, we have no other option but to do this. It is easy to have the colonial mindset of being judgmental to the harlots on the streets. For instance, on my office is on Brigade Road, and I found the bus drivers and the conductors urinating on Brigade Road by the War Memorial. It was a pathetic sight to repeatedly see them do that. I went up to them and I asked them, "Brother, why do you urinate on the road? I'm sure you also feel bad, right?" And they said, "So you're the first person to come and talk to us. The other people were spitting on us because we were doing this." They said, "Sir, we travel from one part of the city to the other part of the city. It takes about 2 to 3 hours. And where do we relieve ourselves? We are human beings. Many of our staff are sick because of retention of the urine." They even said that a woman was pregnant. Because she could not relieve herself, she developed complications and she had a miscarriage. When I approached the managing director of the BMTC, I thought that being a lady, she would be do the honorable thing and install toilets. She did not do it. I had to file a case against her in the Lokayukta and the Human Rights Commission, involved the additional chief secretary and the city minister. But you know what we did next? We installed toilets for them in our office and we gave them the keys and said, "Look, there's no difference between you and me, no difference between you and other people. Here is the toilet. And if you, dear young ones, if you want to make India proud, first believe in your country. Do you believe in your country?" One of the reasons why I'm back here in India is this. I don't have any family in India. My entire generation live in Canada. When I came back and when people asked me, "Why have you come back?" I said this. "It's because I love my country." And when people ask me, "Why do you work with youth so much?" I said, "Because God has an agenda for youth." Let me tell each one of you, regardless of your height, weight, size, or color, each one of you are special. Do you believe that?
Yes.
Look at your neighbor and say, "You are special." Look at your neighbor. Don't look at me. I know I'm special. Each one of you are special. But you know something? Let me illustrate how our Indian mindset is sometimes. It's as if there was a man who ran through a field. He encountered a lion. He fought, he escaped the lion and he ran away. He encountered another animal. He fought and he ran away and he escaped even that animal. Finally, he went into his house. He laid his hand on the wall and he said, "Ah, at last I've survived all these animals." Now where he put his hand, there was a hole in the wall and a snake came through the wall, bit him and he died. That is how we are sometimes. We are our own weaknesses. We condemn our own people. If there is a conflict on the road with a foreigner and with an Indian, we tend to support the foreigner. You know, I was watching a Tamil comedy. And they were beating up this guy. They were beating up there was a conflict between a fair-skinned Tamilian and a dark-skinned Tamilian. So these people said, "Oh, the guy is fair-skinned, he won't sell lies. The guy with the black skin is the guy who says lies." Stereotypes. There can never be language equality, let me tell you this. You look at our country, for example. In Canada, do you speak Canada to your friends? It's mostly English. Do you speak Kannada in your college, in the office? Okay, take our offices for example. They prefer a lateral language as English. But language stereotype is this: just because somebody cannot speak English, we cannot put him or her down. God has created each one of us equally. How? God has created each one of us equally, but uniquely. If each one of us do not have that uniqueness, we would be nothing less than robots. It is because God loves each one of you intrinsically, regardless of what you do. Each one of you become special. And if there's one message I would leave with you this morning, is this. I want to state a question that Martin Luther stated a long time ago. Well, let me not quote him. Let me quote another rights activist from the US. He said, Don't ask what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. It may be a cliche, but this is the question that I have asked myself 10 years ago. And let me tell you this, a bit of my testimony so you understand the background of what I'm talking about. I've grown up in an Anglo-Indian family. Because I did not look like anybody, I was tormented, I was called names, I was beat up, I was thrown out of the house, I was rejected by my father. Growing up in a huge colony, I was sexually molested for many years. And because of that tragedy, I could not study. I failed in 5th standard, in 6th standard, failed thrice in 7th, and I was kicked out from school. And everybody called me a stupid, a dunce, and a no good. But I knew that there was something about me, and I needed to discover what that was. And I found that something when I went before God, and I said, God, either you take my life or tell me my purpose. And this is when I confronted myself. And to cut a long story short, people who were supposed to be clever, supposed to be big shots, they are okay today. But finally, someone who's dropped out from school, I finished on the top of my class at Harvard and Oxford. And this is the message. This is the message. If I can leave you with this, that you are special regardless of the suppression you have faced in your community, regardless of the suppression you face in your family, regardless of the suppression and the stereotyping that you have gone through as an individual. Thank you for listening. God bless you.
Well, let me straight away start, go on to the topic, male abuse. Most of you must have been touched in many ways which you feel is wrong. Correct? Many of you would have been looked in the wrong way by men. Could be auto drivers, could be pedestrians, could be motorists. They look at you like they've never seen a woman. Correct? Okay. See, we are dealing with a sexually depraved society. I don't know if you would agree with it. All of you, none of you are over 20 years old here. Okay, we are dealing with, what is sex? Sex is a basic need in each one of us. Okay? Just like food, just like water, sex is a need. So we have men. What do you do when men look at you like they've never seen a woman? What do you do? Most of you would just lower your eyes down and walk past it. Pretend like it has never happened to you. Okay? Some of you, the tough ones, might even turn around and challenge the person. Hey, why are you looking at me like that? Okay, men might, pass by on motorcycles, on their vehicles, make some lewd comments at you when you go past. See, we are dealing with, this is a reality of life. Okay, now which one of you here in this room can say that you have not been touched wrongly by any man? Most of us are touched wrongly by a man. Sometimes, many times, it could be in buses, it could be on the road. Okay? Now, this is the problem. But if you stop to think, where is the root of it? If you stop to think for a second, where is the root of it? Why is this man behaving like an animal? Why is this man looking at me like an animal? If you stop to think, you would perhaps come to understand one key point in this. That man himself could have been molested. That man himself could have been molested. That man himself could have been abused. We're dealing with the reality of if you look at it statistically, nearly 70% of the children, both men and women, have been abused. Okay, it's a very scary statistic, because in the Times of India, a survey pointed out the numbers could go up to as high as 79%. So what happens when a person is touched wrongly? What happens? Is a touch as simple as a touch? Can someone just touch you and go away? What happens? See, a touch communicates something. Correct? It leaves you traumatized for days, for years. A simple touch in your childhood, you still remember it with all the painful memories. You know, people, if you look at the, you know, there is a theory called the Joe Harry theory. This is in psychology. There is a part of me which I know and you know. Okay, the Joe Harry theory puts us in four parts. One part of me I know, you know. One part of me I know, but you don't know. One part of me you know, but I don't know. And one part of me both of us don't know. Okay, this is called the Joe Harry's theory. Now, a touch, if you look at it, it especially the wrong touch, I'm talking of abuse among men. Men carry it in their subconscious minds. It is deep down there, cemented. You know, it is like a solid cement block. If you can, especially the people who are abusers, you know, many of them are victims of abuse. If you accost them, if you ask them, why is it? Why are you behaving so badly? And if you go into the root, you would realize there is an abused child deep down there. So whenever you walk on the road, you see this, some of these men, and some of the men, they're very introverted, they're very shy, you know, because of this abuse. Their personality suffers scars. Okay, now why don't we talk about this? Why don't we talk about this? We don't talk about it because sex is something we never talk about. We are still a nation, we are still a people who tell our children that the stock brought us. Okay, we are still a people who deny the existence of sex. So nobody talks about it. It's all just suppressed deep within. Even to say that I am abused would be a taboo. Okay? You don't have people like Dominic Dixon who would come on the stage and say, I've been abused with all boldness. Why is he saying it? Why is he saying it? He's saying it to tell you that even when a person is crushed, you know what abuse does to a person? It just crushes the person. If you've seen tissue paper, after you use it, you just crush it, throw it. Even after you've been crushed, there is still life. You know, the person who could be tormenting you, the person who could have tormented you in the past, could be a victim of abuse. You know, I don't know. This would not be the right forum to ask you, but you understand what I'm talking about. If you look at your own lives, if you have been touched wrongly, if you've gone through the trauma, you know what I'm talking of. Why am I talking this to you as a news reporter, as a news anchor? Why am I talking this to you? Because I also serve as a counselor. I'm a counselor at the Family Welfare Center, where it is my, you know, like Seva, like people do Swachh Bharat. So this is my area of Swachh Bharat. So this is my Seva, where I work out. I work with couples. You see, men sometimes addicted to pornography. You see also women addicted to pornography. Where is the root of it? The root could be in a wrong touch. Because I wish that you have initiation classes into sexuality. But most of us hide it. We don't. We learn sexuality the wrong way. We either see it from forbidden literature, we see it from forbidden sites, we see it from forbidden talk, from taboo, you know, peer group telling each other, hey, this, that, you know. We learn it from all the wrong sources. So, what happens to us is, we have an incomplete picture of our sexuality. So when I work at the, where I do honorary work at the Family Welfare Center, I try and when, especially in counseling, if such issues come up, you know, most men would like to deny it. Most men would like to put on the facade of being a tough guy. You know, most men would not acknowledge that they've been abused. All those, you know, statistics point out that about 70%+ have been abused. 70%+. Also, most of you, I would also like to raise this one point with you about pornography. Okay. You know, some of you might, there have been instances where there was this mother, she's a divorcee, and she had a grown-up son, someone who studied in college, and the son used to sit at the computer all night. She thought he was like Einstein, a genius, you know, she was perhaps searching for the halo around his head. Okay, till one day she realized that he was hooked onto pornography. This is another monster. If there are any one of you who have relatives who are hooked onto it, or you yourselves have a problem with pornography, let me tell you that pornography is one of the offshoots of abuse. One of the offshoots of abuse. It's abuse and pornography go so much hand in hand. Because, you know, people who have been abused develop an insatiable desire for sex. All the time sex. It's in their mind. It's, you know. So, if some of you are there, try and understand that it is not a problem without a solution. There are solutions. There is professional help which is available. If you know someone or if you yourself have an issue, please seek professional help. You have counselors around the place. You have many professional counseling centers. Please seek help before it is too late. Don't wait for a disaster to happen. Don't wait for an emergency to happen. The reason why I'm telling you all this is so that you look at this entire issue, you look at it with that renewed awareness. Okay. Also, since most of you are just students, I would like to believe that many of you will be getting married in the next coming years. When you have a little child, okay, this is the key part. As prospective mamas, when you have a little child, do not allow strangers access to your children. We are still a nation where we have burglar alarms, we have watchmen, security at the gate, but we still leave our little children, our sons and daughters, with that unknown uncle from next door or unknown auntie from next door. Correct? Correct me if I'm wrong. We are still a nation. We have so many safeguards for different things, but we are woefully unaware of this problem of child sexual abuse. Just a simple touch, even words could abuse them, just words. So as mamas growing up to be, prospective mamas, let me tell you, be aware all the time. Your child, however small the child could be, I've known of instances where a child less than 1 year old, a male child less than 1 year old, someone kept fondling the genitals of that child less than 1 year old till the child came to something like a climax, a small 1 year old child. So this is as perverted as pervert can be. Are you with me? So don't think, okay, my child is too small, oh, nothing can happen, I'll leave my child next door with this auntie, that auntie looks very nice, that uncle looks very good. I'm sorry, good looks don't matter in this business. Good looks don't matter in this business. It's a dirty world, play it safe. Even if your child is a son, be careful. Even if your child is a daughter, be careful. In most instances, more boys are abused than girls. And we have seen the growth pattern of children abuse. They are scarred for life, low self-esteem. Many of them attempt suicide. Many of them attempt suicide. Some succeed. They get married. Marriages are scarred. Have you seen a physically handicapped person, someone without an eye, someone without a hand? You've seen? Have you seen a sexually handicapped person? No. They disguise themselves as normal. Okay? They disguise themselves as normal. Because that's a secret area, it's an area hidden with shame. So, I would really like to end on this note that be aware. Okay, thank you.
A very good morning to the principal, to all the dignitaries, and to the very beautiful teachers and all the students here. And I must say, ever since I've passed out, all the teachers and our principal have looked the same. So I think they've all sat in the refrigerator. Yeah? Because if you'd seen them 9 or 10 years back, they've looked exactly the same. So it's very nice to be here, and I'm honored that you'll have called me here. I know all the dignitaries have already spoken to you about everything, every single topic very beautifully. So I don't think I'm qualified enough to talk to you all on a very professional level, but I'm going to talk to you all on a very interactive level, because I've been there and I think I'm still there because I'm still stupid. So we'll talk about my movie experiences later, but I think the topic that we girls and I have faced it, the colonial mindset, as they put it. But the colonial mindset, I think, in a different way we'll talk about it, that is in college students, because in school we're so busy studying that we forget about all this fair skin, dark skin, all that is not a thing. We just need to pass 10th and get into college. But in college is where I think we really start, because let's face it, we're a completely fair and lovely obsessed nation, right? So how many of you all have one fair and lovely tube in your purses? No? Man, you guys are good, because I had lots of them. Okay, so when I started off in college, I remember we were all the time putting some fairness cream or at least bleaches, right? Oh wow. Either you're all lying, or I think our batch was really bad. Yeah? Our batch was bad, because we were, girls who were obsessed with a lot of fairness and fairness tubes and, whole lot of bleaches and everything. All we wanted to do was look fair. Whereas when I joined the industry which was popularly known, because, this fair skin was most popular in industry, I think a couple of years back, where everything needed to be fair, and, even if we went in for auditions, people would be like, salpa bellak irbekamma, So, but I must say, lots has changed in the industry now. I'm from the Kannada industry, and I'm proud to say that dusky skin or dark skin is now more acceptable, because you can ask the cameramen here, because I think dark skin looks much better on camera. Yeah? Yeah, see, he's agreeing, So this obsession of
fair complexion and you know, dark complexion needs to be stopped. I think we from college itself, we need to stop this obsession, because there's a nation full of wherein advertisements where, you know, they're always proclaiming fairness creams, but come on, we are Dravidians, we are dark and we are beautiful. Because if you notice that, especially Indians, we have very, very significant features. Okay, and each one of us is very beautiful in our own way. And like Dr. Dominic said, you know, we forget that we are beautiful. So we're so obsessed looking at, you know, other things and magazines. Let me tell you, it's all Photoshop, by the way. Yeah? Because you all are busy taking selfies and Photoshopping it, right? So my experience and my advice would be to stop that. And colonial mindset, I feel, is not just confined to fair and dark skin. Also, anything that is international is like done. Because I remember, you know, for the longest time, somebody told me, use olive oil for diet. And I used only olive oil. But whereas, hello, coconut oil is the best. Yeah? Yes, but y'all go home and dribble that olive oil on your plates. But always remember, what we have in India is always the best. I think I lost most of my weight, or I managed to maintain myself with only the Indian products like coconut oil, Indian food. You know, especially in your diet, we're so busy thinking that cornflakes and oats is going to do it. But no, I think the Indian chapati, rice, everything and minimal is the one that will actually make you look beautiful at the end. Okay, this is a personal experience, because every time I have opted for something else, it's always backfired, because we have grown up since our childhood eating Indian food, and this is what suits our constitution. This is what is going to make us look better, and this is what is going to help us. So I think the whole obsession with all this, I think we should start, especially as college students, because we're so influenced. Anybody says anything, influenced. The minute anybody says, use that product, we're all buying that product, right? Oh, come on. we have our students of nose here, like, I know all of you are doing everything, Okay. So I think this is something, this is a topic I wanted to share with y'all, especially because from when I was in college, my obsession to fairness or my obsession to products or things that were international were more, till I learned what we have is the best, including your workouts. You know, we have yoga, and then we still want to do Pilates. But of course, do it. But I think, you know, stick to what is here. It'll really help y'all. And another topic that I'd really like to touch upon, which our inspector already spoke to y'all about, was cybercrime. Although I don't know much about it, it's something I'd like to share with you all, because I myself am a victim of cybercrime. Because after I joined movies, there was a whole lot of stuff on the internet that I had no control of. And even when I went on the cybercrime office department, they said that there are so many links, right? So it's very difficult to cut each link, so because your photographs can be morphed. And all these things that you all are on, that is the Facebook, the Twitter, the selfies, okay? I want you all to know that the cell phone is not safe, okay? Especially your WhatsApp, that you all are always WhatsApping, you know? See this top, see that, see the skirt. Just be very, very careful, because what photograph you all are posting somewhere, or the photograph that y'all are sending on WhatsApp, is not safe at all, because it is not sent just to that person. It's somewhere in the thing, so it can be misused anywhere. I hope I'm right on that topic, sir. Right? So I want you all to be careful. And my experiences in the movies has been great. I am a product of this college, and have enjoyed and been taught beautifully by the teachers here. And I think it's a great industry to be in, and I've learned a lot. And more importantly, I've learned a lot from my college, because I think this is the foundation where I learned to be stable and grounded. And I hope all of you all too, I see a lot of beautiful girls here. I'm sure you all will grow up to be something here. And I want you all to remember, and please remember what your lecturer said, because I once remember Mrs. Shilpi Chowdhury, one of my favorite lecturers, who had always used to tell me, time, Shubha, time, it's never going to come back. You know, don't miss out on time. She would keep on telling us in class, don't miss out on time, because once you lose out on time, y'all can't do anything. And we never realize it till today. Today I say, oh my God, how much time I wasted, you know, on so many things. So they'll tell you some advices, which we in college is very easy because we're young then. So remember everything. Good luck to all of y'all. And thank you so much to everyone to give me this opportunity. Thank you.
Hi. So this question is to Mr. Bansi Kalappa. Yeah, so Mr. Kalappa, yeah, okay. So what is your take on the recent ban on porn websites?
Okay, see, let me tell you that porn is available in the community. I don't know if you understand. This harmless looking device, people call the cell phone, it looks very harmless, correct? But yet you see the youngsters glued to it. Sometimes you see two or three men watching something, and the moment you come, they are startled and they turn it off. And this is the instrument three legislators are watching in the assembly. So you can understand this device doesn't need, you don't need, even if you can, even if you ban all the 850 or the 850 is not the total number. There's a much higher number. Even if you ban all of them, it's available here. You get packages for as cheap as 30, 50 rupees, high-tech packages. Because porn, there are different varieties of porn. Why it is so dangerous, I'll tell you. Because after someone watches porn for, let's say, a period of time, they watch soft porn. After that, they graduate. That doesn't excite them anymore. Okay? They have to watch something harder. Okay, all right. They have watched something harder. Then they have to watch something even harder. At higher levels, there is something called rape porn. There's something called child porn. There's something called snuff, where you rape a woman and you murder that person. You understand? So porn, the entry point of porn seems fun, but the exit point sounds miserable. I'll tell you the story of a man. His name is Jitin. He is a man from India who went abroad, who practiced in the US as a professional for many years. He is a man who goes around schools and colleges fighting porn. He is a man who goes to schools and colleges with tears in his eyes. He says he is a victim of porn. He was an engineer. He was also a person who had a degree in chartered accountancy. So that's a rare combination. Engineer plus chartered accountancy, and he had a fabulous practice, but his life was destroyed by porn. With tears in his eyes, he goes around campuses saying, you know, how porn has destroyed his life. He's a man who is nearly about late 50s, 60. He says his life is destroyed by porn. He's one man who's talking, but there are a million who are not talking. They're either dead or they're, you know, in their bedrooms. So this man, the porn is not really my area. It's more the area of work of, let's say, someone like Jitin or our good friend, Dr. Dominic here, because he's a psychologist. He works on that area. And there are several others. You know, for example, let me put Jitin's words. Jitin says the only way you fight porn, the second level is, I can give you his number if you could invite him, because you'll never know which child needs, you know, help. You could invite him. I can share that number with madam here, because he's someone who says awareness. First, coming to terms that I'm addicted to porn. And he says the only way you can fight porn is through God. He says you come to God, he specifies the name of Jesus Christ. He says that is the only way you can fight porn. He says you can do anything else, you cannot get out of porn. Because porn is like a prison and that person is captive there. So, if that answers your question.
Are there any risks involved with using public Wi-Fi or an unsecured Wi-Fi?
There is an amount of risk involved in using public and unsecured Wi-Fi, because the ability to hack into these Wi-Fi systems is quite easier compared to the other type of systems, standalone systems. And you can use Wi-Fi to browse sites, to access information, or to do other issues. But when you do your e-banking or anything that is more confidential, it is better not to use Wi-Fi. It is better to avoid it. It is not the probability of the hackers, as we find, it is much easier for them to penetrate the Wi-Fi networks.
If there is a man in an abusive relationship, what should he do about it?
I still didn't follow. What should the man do?
How does he come out of that relationship, or how does he handle the situation?
See, a person who is abusive could have an abused background. It's always, you know, most often abuse comes out of a past. Most of us, you know, you take away our past, what are we? We are nothing. Let's say you take something to make you amnesiac, and you remove all of our past from this panel, we would not know who we are. We would lose our identity. So our behavior is mostly guided by our past. So if someone is in an abusive relationship, a man, maybe if you have access to this person, try and talk to that person and take him for professional help. Because professional help, people have a kind of a block against it. They say, I'm not going to a counselor, I'm not mad. You know, that kind of mindset they have. It's still an area which is considered taboo, going to a counselor. But Dr. Dominic Dixon here and many others, I'm also a counselor, you can walk into any one of these counseling places. Confidentiality is assured. You can go there, tell them your problem very specifically. Many problems are in a few, two, three sittings, it's sorted out. But let's say it's a case of a very deep scar. You know, a few sittings, that's it. So you can walk to a greater freedom. Complete freedom would be in that person's hands, because whether we like it or not, there is this area of will which is under our control. For example, my will is under my control. I have to desire to be free. Okay? So it comes from there. My will is under my control. If I want to be a slave, if I want to be in the prison of abuse, then no matter what, I can't be helped. So the thing starts, of course, with a counselor, but with my decision to walk free.
Sir, is there any law for male abuse?
See, there was this child who I, realized. This child was late in school. This child was in school beyond school hours. And there was some painting work going on in that school. And this was a Montessori school, you know, preschool. And this little boy, someone had held his genitals. Someone had held the genitals of this child. And this child, you know, I went to the police station in Alsur and I contacted one ACP. This was before, he was, of course, DCP in that same police station. But I contacted one of the ACPs there before his time. And that ACP tells me, if it's a girl being abused or molested, there is a law. But if a boy is molested or abused, there is no law. I actually sat with that officer who I know. I don't want to name him here, because otherwise he's a highly decorated officer. He's a great officer who's done a great lot of work for Karnataka. But on this, I felt so let down that I was taking up this child's cause to that officer. And you won't believe it, the person... they did go to the police, called that person who had abused. But the school authorities in that case played foul. They gave this victim's number to that person who had abused. So the victim landed up at that abuser, you know, at that victim's house and said, please let me go and all that. And that fellow was so psyched up, he just dropped the case. Are you with me? This is before POXO. Now you have POXO, which is like you know the POXO sections, which is to prevent child abuse. But this was before POXO came in. So the people just left that case. So, you know, now we are waking up to this issue of child abuse. The best thing is you go to a counselor. Seek professional help. That will be the best. But male abuse still is now under the law, under POXO, it is a defined area.
Would you kindly elaborate about what a bot, B-O-T, is as far as cybercrime is concerned?
See, every computer or any terminal from where you are sending the messages, it has a specific IP address. The port from where the messages, from where the signals are going out into the internet, that usually is called the port, that in common terminology, and it always has a designated IP address. And it is used to track down any cybercrime related incidents to find out where the message has originated from, where the signal which has hacked a particular system or committed a particular crime has originated from. But there are certain tools by which the IP address can also be spoofed. Spoofing means you can mask the IP address in such a way the IP address will be something else. And there are certain sites which are available where you can make use of the tools to spoof it. And most of the hackers make use of it, but the government agencies, the law enforcement agencies are also tracking down these spoofing tools, the websites which provide these spoofing tools, and we are trying to neutralize them or try to stop them from hosting such tools. But this is an ongoing process and which needs international cooperation also, because some of the sites are hosted in website in systems which are abroad. So it is an ongoing problem which are happening, and we have the entire government, and we have the information technology department at the central level, which is the nodal agency, and which looks into all these things.
Do you think education is more effective if it is in English than in our own language, mother tongue?
You know, there's a great thinker by the name of G.K. Chesterton. He said, if you take a boy who's on a railway station stealing nuts and bolts, and if you put him in college, he will finish his education, come back to the railway station and steal the entire train. Okay? So, education, the language, like I told somebody this, do not judge me by the color of my skin or by my religion, but judge me by the conduct of my character. To answer your question directly, English is a universal language. And if you're going to work in Karnataka, or rather in Bangalore context, for example, even if you're at a pune level, it's good if you know English, right? And people who study obviously have ambitions and aspirations, right? Therefore, primary education in English is what I would support, because I've traveled the world and I've seen that if English is not your primary language, then you're confined to a certain region. But we have nations without boundaries now, right, so to speak. So I would prefer English to be the primary language, but not disqualifying the regional language.
My question is for Dominic, sir. Now that we understand the importance of our language and English has been a very important means of communication, can you please give us some tips as to how we can balance between English and our language, and how we can train the coming generations also?
Just, I think, last week I was on News9 on a discussion of on languages. How come people who come into Karnataka do not speak the local language? If you take our beloved police officer, he was in Tamil Nadu, he learned Tamil. He's come to Karnataka and I guess Kannada embraced him, though he may not have embraced Kannada. What I would say is this, if you're in a particular region, it is only respectable
to attempt to learn the local language. I do not speak Kannada, but I speak Kanglish. Right? And most Kannadigas who do not want to speak English invariably utter a few English words. Right? So there's a conflict in either. Nevertheless, I want to reiterate that we cannot demean the language of the land. It is, how do you strike a balance? Is this, some of us show off, so to speak. No, again, I'm not talking about you girls, I'm talking about the other college girls. All of fantastic girls. You know, some of the girls, it's like this. A guy had come down from the US and he was talking in an American accent, but he had been there just for a few months. And this guy's name is Raj. When he came down, he introduced himself to somebody and said, "Hey, my name is Roger." Really? You know? So, some of us, we go to the other guy, we try to speak to him in English. It is not right. We have other people who work with us or for us, and we try to speak to them in English when we rather speak to them in the language that they understand. When I speak to a Kannadiga in Kannada, he or she really appreciates that. So I think striking a balance is being sensitive to the person that we are dealing with.
I have a question for Mr. Chandrasekhar, sir. Is cybercrime police are well specialized or supervised to deal with any kind of cases?
So you're talking about our capabilities to handle crime. Certainly, it's a new area, and we have certain people who are trained to tackle cyber crime. And cyber crime, there is a good part of it when you look at the cyber crime. The moment you get the IP address and the location of the criminal, then it is all normal crime work, how to track him, how to get him, and how to bring him to law. But the basics of cyber crime, almost most of the inspectors, and they are conversant with it. And it is not the capability, but it is the assistance that we get from the operators. So that by the like you have the various service providers, that is more important, and it takes a long time. Sometimes the servers are hosted outside the nation. Then there's a lot of resistance also in giving the details. And recently I remember there were some abusive messages that a lady was getting on her email and whatever. No? So we were trying to find out the IP address to track down that fellow. It took us at least 3 to 4 months. And I don't want to mention the organization with which we were talking to, a private organization which was providing these services. And we literally had to speak, and we have to explain the gravity of the offense. And then they gave us the address. Once the address was given, he was just saying, we know, of course, we had an idea who it could be. The policemen have that, most of them have that sense from the person's history and the people with whom he was dealing with. We knew who it was. We had already warned him, and we had already threatened him and all, but we didn't have the evidence to charge sheet him. So the moment it came, it was within a day or two, he was arrested and it was charge sheeted. And I feel the capability to investigate cyber crime is not a great capability. We can do it. But at a different level, when you have seasoned hackers using spoofed IP addresses doing it, that needs a different level of expertise that only a few of them have. Whom we use, we also take the help of a private cyber experts also in dealing with when we have complicated cases, we ask them for the assistance. And once we have the assistance, once we zero in on some particular parameters, then it is the basic police work to track the fellow down and get him. So, but there is a lot of requirement, because our people also slightly get unnerved whenever you have the cyber type of case coming up. They feel slightly taken aback, anything which is unfamiliar is slightly, it scares everyone for that matter. So, but we are being trained. There has been training, basic training, which the basic training is included in every policeman's training. We have a basic training where he's given insight as to how these crimes happen and how to tackle them. And we have a panel of experts whom we consult, private experts, when we have a very complicated case, and we have been doing it. But it takes a long time because of the coordination with other agencies, with other private agencies, which take their own sweet time to give the details. And sometimes the details are outside the nation. We don't get it also sometimes.
I have another question for Bansi Kalappa, sir. Who is generally the initiator of male sexual assault?
Well, without being gender specific, it's usually an adult. It could even be a child who has been abused before. For example, there was a case where a child who had been abused at the age of maybe 2.5 or 3 turned into an abuser by the age of about 9. Okay, he had turned an abuser, and he had by the time he came to change, he had abused 2 people. So a person who's been abused can also turn an abuser. So it becomes wired within that person that abusing is right. So often what happens is, I don't know if you realize it, how long does it take for a man, I'm just asking all of you this question, how long does it take for a man to notice a woman? It doesn't take a minute or 2 or 5 minutes. It takes 1/3 of a second. In 1/3 of a second, he's noticed the woman and he is sexually ready. In 1/3 of a second. You understand what I'm saying? So for this person, for this perpetrator, whoever is abusing this child, it takes just so much of time to be ready. So often it is an adult, or if it is a child, it could be a child who has himself been exposed to abuse. Normally men are termed abusers, but abusers could even be women, because any number of cases of abuse by women have also come to light. Okay, and some men think, some youngsters think, if a woman is abusing them, then they're being lucky. Okay, but it's not lucky, because it leaves deep scars. Whether a man is abusing a child or a woman is abusing a child, there are scars. So usually it's someone who's gone through abuse who turns abuser. And in any case, whether it is mild or even small abuse, the best thing is to go to a counselor. Counseling mostly is free. Mostly counseling is free. And to get, unburdened and to go on with life, rather than carry that, burden on their shoulders.
I have a question for Mr. Chandrasekhar. What is the police department doing about websites like Darknet and Agora Market?
We are devising our strategies to deal with these things. Agora Market recently was in news because we caught some drug peddlers who were getting these things. So we are working on it. Let us, I think we will be, see, it cannot be eliminated, because once you, it's like in Ramayana, you have this Ravan has 10 heads, and when the final battle takes place, once you cut one head, it used to come up, one more head used to come up. So it's going to be like that. We have to go to the root of the issue, and most of these servers are hosted in foreign countries. I feel a lot of coordination and has to happen between our through the Interpol and all this, and only then we can have a successful result. So, but we are working on it, and we had a recent case where it was being done, and we are also trying to see how to tackle it, and we are taking some support from other angles also.
My question is for Mr. Chandrasekhar again. I have been a personal victim of cybercrime. Irrelevant pictures of mine were posted on Facebook. The account was made in my name, and pictures were posted. Requests were sent to my relatives, so it had to be someone I knew. Pictures were sent, abusive languages, comments on the pictures, page likings of all irrelevant abusive pages were liked by that account. and abusive messages were sent to all my relatives. We addressed the issue, we took up the matter, placed a complaint in the local police station, even visited the crime branch, cyber crime branch, but nothing was done about it.
I apologize if nothing has been done. If I can know the individual case, we'll certainly do something about it. We try to address most of the issues to the best of our ability. Sometimes we are not successful. If I can know the issue or some crime number after the meeting, you can just tell me. I'll have it looked into properly. Yeah.
Is colonial mindset hindering India's success for its growth?
A colonial mindset, see, every colony that has been colonized, for example, you have the Commonwealth nations, they are doing pretty well. Remember what I gave you, that description of a man who was running and then he escaped from these animals and finally he laid his hand on the wall, which was his own house. It's simply symbolic of what we have inside of us. We cannot blame the British for what they've done in terms of, it's like Bansi was sharing, I'm a victim of abuse, but I did not let that to hinder me. I made a choice. I said, hey, look, I'm going to go out there and this is what I'm going to achieve. And that's what I've done. So though we have been hurt and grieved, we have a choice. And this is the statement I want to make. We were able, as Indians, to drive the colonels out of India, but we are not able to drive colonialism out of ourselves simply because we have got this Raj mentality. You know, my colleague over here, she's a Kannada film actress. The reason why I'm talking this is because I liaison with Bollywood and Hollywood actors. Bollywood actors and actresses think they're more superior than Hollywood, or what would you call us?
Sandalwood.
You know, because of the colonial mindset. But if you look at Hollywood, it's neutral, everybody are the same. So someone that is inferior, not the complex, somebody who is inferior will always suppress someone else to come up. All right? So to answer your question directly, yes, we have been hurt on a certain level, but look, we have so many years of independence. We've come a long way. We built skyscrapers. We built huge buildings. We have the best of institutions. We have an amazing Indian penal code. We have fantastic judiciary, fantastic police force. We have what it takes, but internally, we suppress ourselves. We demean ourselves.
Most men are dominant over women. Then why do they suffer in silence if they are the victim of male abuse?
Okay, see, sexuality is a very deep personal area. Like I explained to you, a person, I don't know how many people you have seen who are blind, how many people you have seen who are polio stricken, but how many people have you seen who are sexually crippled? They would mask it, they would fake it. They would look normal. You know, people around here, you can count all of us in this room and easily 25-30% of us are abused. Can you tell me which ones are abused? So that is a mask we put on. The number here could be 25-30. If you look at certain statistics about, you know, this gentleman here, I really admire his courage. Because he has the courage to go on the stage and say, I was abused. Which one of us has that courage? Tell me. Tell me which one of us has that courage. So that abuse part, most of us, what we do is we cement it in our subconscious. We put a slab of cement on it and on it another slab of cement, and it's deep buried there. Unless you are able to identify, okay, this person has so and so qualities, so perhaps he is abused. We are, you know, as human beings, we are so smart, we are so intelligent, we are able to mask it. We're just able to carry on like normal people. So you don't know who the abuser is. And as far as this dominance of men over women is concerned, I don't know what you're really talking about, in what context. Because I think man and woman are equal. So I don't know in what particular context, but maybe there is a context which man thinks he's superior, so he tries to dominate. I don't know. So maybe.
Namaste. Namaskara to the God in you. Thank you. Now, when I went talking about this topics with my team, we went to most of your classes and we asked you certain questions on who Rousseau is, which our principal about whom she spoke, none of you knew, because you are taught commerce in class or management in class or economics in class. Everything is so custom made. So we have created this platform for you, calling experts and esteemed guests to speak and enlighten y'all. We are celebrating 68th year of our independence. Are we free? We are free physically, but are we mentally free? We are in the cage of our own mindset. And the mindset is color, language, use of internet, and misusing laws that are made for women. We misuse it. Language stereotype that I've been speaking to you all these years, all these weeks. Last week, I've been preparing y'all. Why do we have this fixation with English? Today, I'm using this language as a medium of communication. It's an official language. Why do you want to make it, or we want to make it, the language of status, style, glamour, show off? We all do that. You walk into I recently went to a mall, a small incident I'll give you. This young mother, she had two toddlers, and she was talking to them in Kannada, chaste Kannada. And I was like so happy, wow, she's teaching her children, you know, Kannada language. And the minute I walked in, oh baby, come baby, sit down baby. I don't know what happened to her. It just a turn off and a turn on. So I seriously, I didn't understand that. But this is, we are slaves. When Macaulay left, I won't call him Lord Macaulay because he was a colonist. So for him, for me, and for everyone else, he will remain a colonist. He said, he's a British historian, he was, and he said, when we leave India, we'll see to it that they eat, breathe, and drink English. And don't you think we are doing that? If you cannot speak in English language, you say, Are, she's KMT, Kannada medium type. No, she's HMT, Hindi medium type. Why are we not proud of our roots? Why? We are not proud of ourselves. We are not proud of our language, our culture. This is what the British put in us and left. It's time we address it. That's why we are all gathered today here. Y'all are the future. You are the future of India. Right? So these are the few topics that we discussed, and the color fixation. Gori ladki. The Gora sahabs went, but they left whole lot of brown sahibs and mem sahibs. We are not able to get out of that syndrome. And more so, it happens in Bollywood industry. That's why they're hiring Firangis left, right, and center, and our own people are not getting employment. The same thing is happening with the modeling industry. I was interviewed, I remember, at Prajavani. By the way, I go to a lot of these television channels where I speak in Kannada. My Kannada is not good. I'm not a Kannadiga, but I make an effort to speak in Kannada. And when I tell them, ki nan vyakrana sari illa, then what they say, you know, ishte saku. And I feel so good. Because my, that is my other profession, my designs keep coming in DD and a whole lot of these Kannada channels, and of course the other national channels. But there, I have never faced this kind of a language bar. I mean, I feel so proud that I can speak the local language. For that matter, every language is important. Every language. Respect all the languages. Don't have the stereotype about English that I keep telling to myself also. English is a beautiful language. It's our official language. It is a language of communication. Because if we start talking in all the languages of India, I don't know, it will be a total disconnected country. So we use a language which brings us together. Stop there. We need to stop there, but we don't. So this is to be addressed to, and you know, we are not free to use net. My own account was hacked twice, right? So we are victim to that. So Mr. Chandrasekhar has enlightened you all. Anytime you need help, you can reach out to these eminent personalities who are experts in that, and at a personal level, also get in touch with them, discuss your problems to them. Now, another very delicate topic which nobody talks about, and that's male abuse. We are in a patriarchal society. The males are not allowed to cry, okay? It starts at home. Mard ka bachcha hai, kya roega? Rona nahi hai, rona mana hai. It's macho not to cry, okay? It's macho not to discuss your problems. You cannot talk about your abuses. Whether you're getting battered at home, whether old men are getting battered at home, nobody talks about it because it is embarrassing to talk about it because they have been taught like that. No. Men, you are a man. Churiya pehen ke to nahi baithe ho na. Churiya nahi pehenna hai. Right? So this is the way your conditioning starts right from home. This is to be addressed too. They are embarrassed to talk about their problems. It is always shoved under the carpet. So, male abuse is a very sensitive, you know, a topic. I know women get abused, and it's a male society. You have all right to talk about it, but do not use law. Do not abuse law in your favor. So be sensitive towards the male abuse problems. So we thought, here in your classroom situations, you don't have this kind of exposure. And with, of course, our principal, she is the mover of this entire program. And I have my whole lot of Shakers there. They are my team, and an amazing team. Can you come up on stage, please? These are my happening team members who have been with me for last 3 weeks. Yes? And they have been putting their heart and soul in this event because it's the first time it has been introduced in BCWCC. So this brainstorming we did for you so that you fight the stereotypes. Just wake up the hero in you. Thank you.